Well, hello and welcome to This and That Thursday. This is Red Mountain is the name of this piece. It is a PanPastel painting that I did here at the Kraaft Shaak, and I'm glad that you can join us. I did speed this video up for time purposes because it was about 1 hour and 10 minutes from start to finish with everything. And we're just going to go through and watch me do this, and I'll try to explain some things as I go. So, I'm using a big oval sponge, these soft tools that you can get for pan pastels, and they have a big oval sponge, and I absolutely love that for skies because it's almost like using your hands. And then I lay in the colors that I want. And it's real sloppy. And you notice I'm avoiding where the clouds will be, where the mass of clouds will be. There'll be some smaller ones, like I just put in over there and things, but the mass that I want to be white, I leave with no color. And then I put in the white for the clouds. You saw a little bit of gray for the under the clouds, kind of gives them that. They're up in the sky and they've got just a little bit of shadow under them. And then I sort of blend it out. You see me smoothing and blending. And that's really the simplicity of pan pastels, is that it's the sheer medium that just allows you to layer and layer, and then you can smooth and simplify the stroke. So I like to use the biggest sponge or brush. I call them brushes because that's what we're used to when we paint, is brushes, and it's just a brush that happens to be a sponge that fits in your hand rather than having a stick. So it's just easier for me to call it a brush, but I'll try to remember it's a sponge. But anyway, I try to start with the biggest one possible, just like I would if I was painting with watercolors. And I lay in as much major color and base color as I possibly can. And so you see me doing these large sweeps of color, and it really looks very messy to start with, but it is truly the best way to put in the color when you're working on such a large piece. So these are about 22 inches square. Somewhere around there, 20, 22 inches, this paper that I'm using. And oh, I should have the paper here. I will have a blog post available for this one so that you can see all the supplies and a link to the supplies where you can purchase them if you're interested, and what I used. So, all right, so now what I'm doing is just sort of adding texture and mountains, they have these layers and strata that just sort of creates these lines and patterns, and this mountain especially. So this is actually Mount Camelback is the name of the mountain. It's part of the Camelback Mountains here in Arizona, but it's commonly known as the Red Mountain, and the area surrounding it is Red Mountain Ranch. And I love this mountain. I pass by it all the time, driving to and from most places, because it's right off of the 202, the Loop 202 here in Arizona. And I see it all the time, and I always say I want to paint that thing. So one day we're driving home from somewhere, and I'm like, you know what? I'm taking a picture. And so you'll see my ridiculous picture. I'm going to put that up on screen later, but that is like the base of what I was painting here. And then I found a much better picture online of the painting. And so I sort of merged the two and create a much better image. So you saw me use a large brush to go in and create the bushes out front there, at least to put them down. And then I use the tip of it to put in the leaves. And now I've moved on to one of the knives They call them knives. To me, these are just another style of paintbrush. And I go in and create the sharper edge with this. It's sort of like a flat brush. And you can hold it in different ways and use different pressures, and that allows you to, just like you would with a pencil or even a paintbrush, and it allows you to put in different marks and create different strokes. And so one of the things that I did quite a bit in this particular piece is to sort of rock the palette knife, paintbrush, sponge on the end of a plastic tool, whatever you want to call this thing. I sort of rock it back and forth, and I'm going to show it to you. We go quick, pretty quick, so it sort of walks on each side and creates this like jagged line. But we're going to slow it down here. Let's slow it down. And you see I'm sort of twisting, turning, and it's creating these jagged lines. Twist, turn. Basically, I'm rocking it on the surface, the edge to the flat, to the edge, to the flat, and I'm skipping some areas, and it's just a stroke that I'm doing there. So nice and easy. All right, we'll get back to double speed here, quadruple speed, or whatever it is. And I just do that throughout the whole piece and create those lines of strata, rock formations there. So I'm going to explain something to you, and this is a really something that's really enjoyable about working with pan pastels, is much like acrylics, where you can just sort of keep going over and manipulating until you have what you want. So this whole side on the left, this area that I'm working on over here, it goes through many transformations during this entire video, because I really can't see it very well in the picture, and I will, as I said, be putting it up on screen for you to see the picture that I took while we were driving down the freeway. So imagine Mr. Crafter's driving at like 70 miles an hour or whatever, and I'm, oh yeah, that's right, I want to get a picture of that. So I'm frustratingly getting my camera out and then taking through the front windshield as we're driving past at 70 plus miles an hour, trying to take a picture of this thing. Yeah, I took like six pictures, and out of them, the least blurry picture is the one that I'll put up. I'll show it to you. All right, so I've added some purples, and mostly purples, but a few of the cool colors to go in here on top of this red and brown neutral rock. That really helps add with the shadows and the color that is in this red mountain. And then I'm going in with some highlights here, and this is all like light lavender. And I think a little bit of sienna light or something like that. But now I'm cleaning it so that way we can get in and do some details. So here is transformation number one, I guess. As I put up this image here, this is the better image I found of this, and I liked the point of view that this rock had, so or this picture had of the rock, and I wanted to make sure that I also liked that it had cactus in the foreground, and I'm going to be doing that later on, but just trying to get some of those detail marks in here, and maybe show some definition between the various levels of this mountain. And I'm just trying to put in darks and lights to show where it sort of recedes and comes forward and all that. And hopefully you're seeing all that. But don't get married to this, because we're going to change it up real quick here. And this section in the foreground there on the left really bothered me, because as I said in this picture I'm about to show you here that I took with my phone, you can't really see much of what detail or whatever. So there's the picture I took, and here I'll just put it up on screen for you to see. And now I'm going to just really try to recreate that left side shaping, and then I'll use the other picture to create the foreground, and we'll work on that. So now you see me carving. Basically, I'm carving out the rock that I see on the image. And if you look real close, you can see in the bottom left corner of the picture that I took with my phone that there's sort of like a wisp of a far, way off, far in the distance mountain, and that's what that purple hazy thing there is supposed to be. I will add some lighter colors coming up, but you see what I'm saying? That picture that I took with my phone wasn't all that great, so I had to have something to sort of help me out here. And then adding a little bit of darkness there brings that edge of that mountain forward. And now we'll just add some details and you'll see it just sort of come to life. One of the things about having the video sped up, it is, like I said, sped up to about 4 times faster than normal. I don't obviously paint this quick, but is that you get to see it sort of take shape quicker. Like when we're adding one slow stroke at a time, it just doesn't transform as quick. But when you see it go do 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 do, and all of a sudden there's a line there, and now the shape is just so intense. It's really neat. I know I don't like always doing these types of videos, but for this and that Thursday we try to do short ones. So hopefully you don't mind too much. All right, so I took my magic wand, I really don't know what to call these things, and sort of sketched out where I want some cactus to go. And these cactus are the big saguaro cactus, and some are going to be closer to us and some are going to be farther away. And then I grabbed my vinyl eraser because another cool thing about PanPastels is that you can erase them. And so let's zoom in a little bit as and slow it down to regular speed. And I'm just going in with my eraser and creating the shapes of these PanPastels or these saguaros, where the saguaros are going to go. And there's a couple of stately ones up front, and then the rest are just going to sort of be lines. And so I'm just going to remove some of that PanPastel from the paper using the eraser. And I'll do a couple on the other side as well. And you'll see why that was important, because as we go in to put in the greens and create the image, now you'll notice that what I'm painting is not exactly what I erase. So I'm actually, it didn't have to be perfect is what I mean. I just erased some of it so that that green will show up a little bit better. And then I'm going in and very sloppily, really, just creating these shapes of greens, and I'm using probably 2 or 3 different colors of green, and bouncing around between the dark and the light, or the shade and the tint of those colors, so that that way I have sort of a variation of where the light is hitting. And now you'll see I'm adding also in some more of those, even though I hadn't erased. And if you look at it now, you can see the ones where I erased are much more intense, they're brighter, they come at you more. The other ones that are just lines that I added over the top of the previously painted area sort of fade away, and they look much further away too. So that helped with that, and that's why we use the eraser to give ourselves some more intensity on what we are painting. So now I'm just going to put a little bit of shadow underneath a couple of them, add some dark lines that sort of represent, like, you know, these things are not perfect. They are actually plants, and animals, especially birds, really like to burrow in them, and so they have these marks on them and they just look alive. So I really wanted some of those, especially those two in the front, to have a little bit more detail like that. All right, so now we're going to work a little bit on this foreground, which I sort of created a, I don't know, it's a bush of some sort. So I'm thinking like Palo Verde trees. I'm thinking, you know, it's just a lot of shrubbery, but it's not like low to the ground shrubbery. This is like treetops we're seeing, or large masses of leafy plant life, desert plant life that is, right at the edge of what when I took this picture, it would be the railing of the freeway. But anyway, so now I did something that I really like to do. I triple loaded the brush, or in this case, it's a triangle shaped palette knife or whatever. I triple loaded it with three different colors, and they're all pretty much the same color, but different shades or tints of that color. And then I'm able to just sort of dance it around on all those three edges and get myself little hints of each of the colors all over the place. And it creates these shadows and lights dancing in the leaves, which is exactly what we want. And I'm sorry that you can't see what I'm doing up at the very top. I didn't realize that I had needed to zoom out, but now I'm just going in with pure white and adding in little wispinesses of the clouds as they're trailing off there, and fixing the edge of that where I may have missed some blue and fixing that there, adding a little bit of detail here to the edges, and basically just cleaning it up and sharpening up whatever needs to be done. So you kind of squint your eyes a little bit and you see what's missing or what's standing out at you. And is that really what you want to have popping off the page? If it is, great. If it isn't, then how are you going to fix that? So that's pretty much what I do at that stage. And then a little bit of blending here and there with the tool, and adding more highlights just so that way we can make sure that this is what we want to have our eyes drawn to. Now I'm going to put in some darker on the left side of these, some of these saguaro cactus, and that just allowed them to be a little bit more present. And we'll take the tape off, which I had taped it to this board so it wouldn't move on me, and that created a nice crisp border. And this basically finishes the piece after I sign my name. So I hope that you enjoyed watching this. This is like the quicker, super quick version. If you want to see a full-length version of doing a PanPastel painting of the same size, we have 4 episodes of Kraaft It Live available. So I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope that you'll take some time to give it a thumbs up, maybe even share, and have a crafty day. Bye-bye now.